Frank, have we got copies? They're coming. Right. Mr. Packer, would you have any problem if we started to distribute the copies of your statement to the press? Would you have any problem if we started to distribute copies of your opening statement now?
Yeah. Okay. We got all the photographs done, and then we could get down to actually being serious about it,
okay,
rather than just being a circus.
Okay. Well, what we're doing is we're giving members a chance to read the opening statement, which I think Mr. Packer's not intending to read out the statement, so if people wish to read that before we start the hearings, now's your chance to do so. Yeah. Have we got those copies down there? They're coming, okay. Well, I think we've allowed enough time for members to read the opening statement. At this stage, I welcome Mr. Kerry Packer, the chairman. First of all, I declare open this afternoon's proceedings of the print media inquiry. And I welcome Mr. Kerry Packer, the chairman of the Australian Consolidated Press. And I'll ask the secretary to read the oath, to administer the oath or affirmation, please.
Understand it?
Do you swear that the evidence you shall give on this examination shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, to help you, God?
I do.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. For the Hansard record, Mr. Packer, could you please state your full name and the capacity in which you appear this afternoon, please?
Kerry Francis Bullmore Packer. I appear here this afternoon reluctantly.
Thank you. I should point out there that, in fact, it was my request to Mr. Packer last week after seeing the current affair video that you've agreed to appear today. Would you care to make any opening statement before the committee proceeds to questions?
I'm sorry, I'm having trouble hearing you, sir.
We might need to turn up the sound and vision feedback if we could. Would you care to make any opening statement before the committee asks you questions?
No, I have distributed to the committee an opening statement, which if you would have it read into Hansard or taken as being in Hansard,
okay, well,
that is my position. Maybe it would save everyone a little time, I think.
Is there any objection to the statement being incorporated in Hansard? That's moved and seconded. There being no objection, I declare that carried. So would you care to make any verbal statement before questions?
No.
All right.
Here it's your pleasure, gentlemen.
Okay, well, perhaps I could...
Ladies and gentlemen, I stand corrected.
Mrs. McHugh has a very strict policy on these issues. Perhaps I could start with a few questions on control, since that seems to be the area where most people have perhaps criticised the Turing Consortium. And I note in your opening statement, which I understand we're having distributed as soon as possible to other members who are watching today, that you've made it clear that it's not your intention to exercise any control over the Turing bid if it's successful in purchasing the John Fairfax Group. Is that correct?
Will I not exercise any control? I can't. It's a combination of won't and can't and don't want to.
Some people have suggested that while your shareholding is limited to 15% and Mr. Black's shareholding will initially be 15 and perhaps later 20, that the fact that the remainder of the shareholding is distributed widely might mean that those small strategic shareholdings might be enough to control the company. How would you respond to that criticism?
I would have thought that in a chamber such as this, numbers were understood very well. As I understand it, there's been leadership struggles in this parliament and people with 40% can't get their men up, let alone with 15. So, 15% does not control. And I think what we must bear in mind is that all the Commonwealth legislation turns around and states that 15% is the amount of something that people can have in this country, and it's deemed not to control. That's the limit. which the Commonwealth says does not control. And I don't control. I have no arrangements with Conrad Black or with the Telegraph, which gives me any rights whatsoever. And I've made that very clear, I would have thought, in the statement.
What can you tell us about the genesis of the Turang bid?
It's all there in the statement.
How did it come about? I mean, in an informal discussion with Mr. Black, or when did it start?
Are we talking about the formal putting together of it, or are we talking about...
No, informally between you and him.
Informally, 1990, I think. You know, I spoke to Conrad Black, who I met for the first time at a dinner, and we obviously spoke about Fairfax, as people who were involved in the media tend to do. And he said he was interested, or words to that effect. I said, well, you know, if the time comes and we all get together, let's look at it. Now, I don't know whether he said it or I said it or who said it, but that's where it basically started. Then, in 1991, we were approached by Turnbull's and by Ord Manette with the bondholders. Now, the bondholders, at that point in time, Conrad Black and I had spoken about it maybe three or four times in the course of a year. At that point in time, it became time to either get into the act or not. And at that point in time, there was a meeting, and we decided to go ahead with Ord Manette and Turnbull and the bondholders, and I think that was in June or July 91. And that's when the agreements were drawn up, and that's when the whole action, real action, started. Up until that point in time, it had been general conversation.
Part of the confusion may have arisen. Part of the confusion may, and I think we're getting close to our 10 minutes. Thank you. Part of the confusion may have arisen because I think on the current affair debate, you implied that Mr. Black might control the Fairfax Group if Turang was successful. I think you might have used the expression that Mr. Black might fix the newspapers. But I noticed in Saturday's interview in the Sydney Morning Herald, Mr. Black said that he would not control the group. Could you perhaps clarify that?
There is going to be 65% of the shareholdings of Fairfax, which will be owned by the public and the institutions exactly the same way as they are owned by every other public company that you see. There's no great mystery about this. Now, there's 15% that will be owned by myself. That takes a total of Australian ownership to 80%. Now, Mr. Black is starting off as deputy chairman and will be responsible, presumably, for putting the management or some part of it together, because he is the newspaper man who's there on the board. So it would be unreasonable to expect that his opinions won't carry a considerable amount of weight while they're putting the whole structure together. Now, at that point in time, he will be in charge. Whether he continues to be in charge or whether he loses that position will depend entirely on the way the Australian public, shareholders, not public, perceive him and the job they do in running John Fairfax. He can be voted in or voted out just exactly the same as any person who leads any other company.
I suppose some people might be concerned that crucial decisions about who the chief executive would be, whether editors are replaced, would be made in that period between when you were successful and when the float might occur.
Let's be perfectly clear. Turang is a company which is not responsible or restricted in any way, shape or form at this moment in time. It owns nothing. It has nothing. It's not subject to the Australian Broadcasting Tribunal. It's not subject to this Parliament. It's not subject to anything because it owns nothing. Now, the moment it owns John Fairfax and Sons, written into the articles or written into the agreement of that company, is a shutter which comes down and says, Kerry Packer is not involved in the management of that company. And nobody has any commitments to anybody else. So the day that it becomes the acquirer of the shares in John Fairfax, I have exactly the same rights and influence as any other shareholder who is not a board member. Considerably less if you go on to read the document that I've distributed to you. But I still have some rights, but not many. and I have no ongoing agreements which put me in a position of control or influence.
But I think we're at the end of our 10 minutes, so those rules that we said would apply after the first 10 minutes are applying from now on. Thank you. And Mr. Smith?
Do you have any agreements or arrangements with any of your companies and any of Mr. Black's companies anywhere else in the world?
None. I've met Mr. Black 3-4 times in my life before this. Before, you know, this year. I've met him in England last year for the first time. I've known him at 3 or 4 dinners, and that's how well I know him.
At the beginning, you talked about that early meeting, and yeah. One of the keys in this whole issue is the exclusive arrangement that Turang has with the junk bond holders and the preemptive rights that you have to purchase the junk bond holders. How did that come about, and was that a precondition of your own involvement to know that you'd be able to secure that later on?
As I told you, Malcolm Turnbull, on his own bat, his own volition, went out and tied up the junk bond holders. And he delivered those junk bond holders to someone.
What happened?
We sat down there and said, all right, they look like being an asset in buying this company. So we agreed to do the deal.
What happens if you exercise the preemptive rights in terms of the... who's going to actually pay? It'll be the yourself as a 15% shareholder. Who gets the benefit if you exercise the preemptive rights to purchase the junk bondholders?
I'm having a little trouble where you're coming from.
If you exercise the rights for the preemptive purchase of the junk bondholders, mm-hmm. what effect does that have on the shareholding structure of Turang, as we now know it from the information
None
given to
all.
Us by Mr. Kennedy?
None at all. Turang will be out of the business by then. But if you think I'm going to be railroaded and sit here and be told that you're going to change the laws and you're going to push me around, I may well buy them. And if I do, then the only way that Fairfaxes as a company will be able to be sold is individually as assets. I won't be able to buy it. I accept that.
What about the rumour that's been around that you're interested in getting hold of the financial review because
complete
you're...
an absolute nonsense.
So there's no truth at all?
None whatsoever.
Presumably, if you're successful, you'll have to put together a prospectus which will say who the board of directors
are. I won't have to do anything. I am not a director of Turang.
Turang will.
Yeah, but don't ask me about Turang. Once it buys John Fairfax, I have no more say in it than you do, except at the annual general meeting where I can vote 15% of the shares, which may or may not be significant.
So the board of directors will be appointed by whom?
By Turang. I mean, there has got to be a very real chance that the directors and the senior management will be finalised after the purchase of John Fairfax and Son. I mean, the senior management, who wants to leave a secure job at this moment in time to go to a consortium which may or may not be the owner of John Fairfax? So obviously the senior management is going to be appointed after the owner of the winning of the bid for Fairfax. Now, at that point in time, I'm not a director. I will have no say in what Turang does. I mean, none. Zero.
But before Turang,
nor will the directors, in my view.
Right, but before Turang buys the John Fairfax Group, you are involved in putting the group together. I think that's the words.
I'm not involved in the directorships.
Well, okay, not involved in directorships. So
well,
you're saying
that's all there is. There's only management and directors.
So you're saying you'll have no role whatsoever in the selection of the directors for Turang.
That's exactly what I'm saying.
But you have had involvement already.
No, I haven't had. There have been people who have been told that that Zelman Cowan, Conrad Black wanted Zelman Cowan as a director. I said, that's fine with me. It doesn't nothing to do with me. I don't mind. And Lawrence Street, Trevor Kennedy wanted Lawrence Street. Fine. Now, why would they ask me? The truth of the matter is I'm the Australian. Of course they're going to ask me. Why wouldn't they ask me? But I have no influence in that area.
But if you own 15% of the company and you say, no, I don't like this particular nominee, won't they pay attention to you?
Of course they're not going to listen to me. 15% of a company doesn't give you control of anything. Now, I mean,
I've just... Mr. Black control?
It gives Mr. Black... Mr. Black has a situation where he can sit on the board. Mr. Black is recognised as the newspaper man. Mr. Black is the intellectual person behind the running of those properties. Now, if he's as good as I think he is, he will remain very influential. If he's not, his authority will be taken away by the people who have controlled 65% of the votes.
Why is his 15%?
15.
Why is his 15% any different to your 15%?
Because he's allowed to sit on the board. Don't you know the difference?
Of course, there's some difference there.
I mean, I don't have any contact with the management. I don't have any access to the editors. I don't have any method of talking to people. Mr. Black, on the other hand, as a board member and as deputy chairman, has the capacity to talk to the management.
Are you saying that there's no arrangement, formal or informal, between you and Mr. Black with the control of the press?
It's what I've said ad nauseum in that document. You're either going to have to believe me or call me a liar. I am telling you there is no arrangement. And I'm sick of telling people there is no arrangement.
That is
the situation. There is no arrangement. There is no agreement.
Formal
I am not
or
in a position.
Informal.
What? Of course formal or informal. Implied or anything else. I'm sick of trying to tell you all. I am not going to run John Fairfax's. And what's more, I don't want to.
Dr. Charlesworth?
Given the success of... let's presume AIN was successful and then went ahead and floated the company, there would be nothing to stop you buying 14.9% of those shares.
I assume
we should... Your interest in this company is because it's a good investment in the long term.
My interest in this company is that... It goes to quite a few things, but if I can answer your question another way. If I wanted to control Fairfax, I sell Channel 9. And at that point in time, this inquiry and everything else that goes on with it is a waste of time. I have every right, as an Australian citizen, to go and buy John Fairfax and Sons. Now, there is nothing that any of you can do about that. I have decided I want to remain in television. And I accept, and I have accepted, from day one, that you cannot control television and newspapers. And I have accepted that. And I have made my decision. My decision was to stay in television. And I do not have any agreements with anyone that contravenes the law.
The point I was trying to make is that, given that scenario, you can own 15 or 14.9% through another route.
Easily.
I
can do that, as you say, and I can go to the public float and buy 14.9%, or I can sell the television stations and own up to 100%. I mean, I am not being stopped because I can't find a way round. I am being stopped because I accept that that is the rule of law in this country. And I accept that law. And I can't say it enough times.
If AIN or O'Reilly are successful, will you consider buying 14.99% of those companies?
I haven't got that far. I don't have a clue.
You're not ruling out the possibility?
Not ruling out. Listen, there is no way that O'Reilly or AIN should be able to top the bid that has been put in. The only way it will be topped is by political interference. Now, I do not hold that political interference will actually happen.
Mr. Costello, then Mr. Sawford.
Mr. Packer, can I just come to this question of the influence over the company? And I'm not going to ask any questions about control, which is a matter for the Australian Broadcasting Tribunal, as you've said. Let's just imagine that Turang owns John Fairfax. The first annual general meeting is coming up. The board is up for re-election. You are entitled to vote your shares.
Yes, I am.
Mr. Black is entitled to vote his shares.
Yes, he is.
There is nothing in law that says you aren't allowed to discuss your view with Mr. Black, is there? And you could both decide to vote your shares.
Are you a lawyer, Mr. Costello?
Pardon?
Are you a lawyer?
Yes.
Well, you're going to know what's in the law much better than I would.
Yeah, but you'd agree with
I don't know whether that's in the law or not in the law. Yeah. But at some time before I have a conversation with Mr. Black, I'll ask the lawyers.
All right.
And they'll advise me what is proper and what is correct.
Okay, so let's assume then that in complete compliance with the law, you discuss your views and you have a unanimity of opinion. Now,
why are we going to have a unanimity of opinion?
Well, let's just suppose.
Well, let's suppose we don't.
And then there's 65% who are mum and dad people, and they have invested in this company because they think Kerry Packer's good at making money, and so they decide, or at least 15% of them decide, that they'll go with Kerry Packer because he's got business acumen.
They can't go with Kerry Packer, he's not eligible to go on the board.
No, but they go with him in an annual general meeting on his recommendation as to who should be a director.
Why are you making a recommendation?
Well, I'm sorry, but shareholders can and regularly do make recommendations.
I don't.
As to who should be directors. We're watching a proxy fight at the moment over who should be directors in Foster's Brewing.
Yeah.
Now,
what percentage of the shares have they got?
I'm not for a moment suggesting, that gives you control in the legal sense. But I'm saying it is not outside the realms of possibility, is it, that you, Mr. Black, in a proxy war would start a long way ahead of anybody else in the election of directors?
Well, I suppose having put up a couple of $100 million, we'd be entitled to start somewhere, wouldn't we?
I'm not saying it's wrong for a moment, Mr. Packer, would you agree with that proposition?
No,
it's
not agreeing, it's not or disagreeing beyond with anything you're saying. I'm not here to answer hypothetical queries. For God's sake, if you can show me where I'm doing something wrong, show me, and I'll correct it.
I'm not for a moment suggesting you're doing anything wrong. What I'm saying is you could act entirely properly.
It is your
and
law.
Start a long way ahead of anybody else in the nomination of directors.
Here, which we are discussing. You as a parliament have passed a law and said, this is what I may do. I have been to the lawyers, I've got a statement there for you to read, and I will do everything within the law that I'm allowed to do, not one thing more, and I will behave with a complete compliance to the law.
In the event I just want to finish this question. Because I'm not asking you about control, nor am I joining
what's the purpose of the
any
question?
Campaign. My question is, do you agree that you would start off a long way in front of anybody else
what is a
proxy war as to who would be the directors of Fairfax?
What is do the you purpose agree with of that? Your question if you're not trying to prove control?
I just want to feel out the possibility of the influence, not the control, the influence that you would exercise in Fairfax. And I ask, would you in fact start a long way in front of anybody else in a proxy battle to name the directors in Fairfax?
I think you've got to understand a few things to start with. I don't know. It's not my understanding that directors usually come up at the same time in a company. It's usually staggered over a 2 or 3 year period,
sure.
Isn't it? So maybe there'll be 2 or 3 directors come out of 10.
Sure.
Say it's over a 5 year period. That's 2 directors per annum.
Sure.
Wouldn't matter what happened to the proxy war,
sure.
Would it?
But on the 2 that are up this day, this annual general meeting, do you agree with the question that you would start off in front of anybody else?
Well, that depends on who the other shareholders are. If the AMP Society, which has chosen to speak on this matter in the form of AIN, if National Mutual both decided to buy 15% of the shares in John Fairfax, then the answer, and they wanted to oppose these people, the answer would be no. I mean, your question is so hypothetical, how can I answer it?
Well, I'm asking you on the basis of your 15%, Mr. Black's 20%, and a widely dispersed share registry as to the balance.
Why are you assuming it's a widely dispersed share registry?
Well, you're putting in a lot of other hypotheticals about the AMP.
What hypotheticals am I putting in?
About the possibility of the AMP and the National Mutual having large
shares. Well, there's no doubt that these shares will be sold to institutions. You think that's hypothetical?
No, it's what is
hypothetical. Well, don't you know that institutions often
vote
together?
What is hypothetical is as to the amounts. But my proposition to you is that if you have 15%, Mr. Black has 20%, and there is a wide dispersal as to the rest, although you don't control the annual general meeting, you start off well in advance of anybody else who seeks to control the
I don't accept that at all.
All right.
Well, Mr. Packer, can I ask a question on Channel 9 on media?
Yes, you can. Mr. Salford.
How much of Channel 9 network do you own, Mr. Packer?
45, I think 14, 38, 38, sorry.
38. Do you control 50. It, Mr. Packer?
Absolutely.
You do? With
absolutely.
38%?
Absolutely.
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 What happens to the other 62% ownership?
They turn up at the meetings and vote with me because they're very happy with the job I'm doing. They've all gone from being bankrupt to getting shares which are worth 70 cents. They can vote me out any time they like. They haven't got a problem in the world.
Mr. Salford.
But they don't bother to.
Mr.
Packer.
What's the difference between... The difference is between 38 and 15 is 27.
The difference between 62 and 65.
62 and
65,
sorry.
62 in Channel 9.
I'm the chairman. I'm the
65
person.
65 in Terrain.
I am the chairman. I am on the board. I run the company. There's absolutely no doubt I run the company.
But you have
I go to meetings every single week. God forgive me. And I have to go there and go to work and do the thing. I make decisions all the time. There is no doubt I run Channel 9.
And the other 60% just accept it, quite happily.
No, they not only accept it, they are delighted for me to do it.
Right.
But you have said that 65% would control Terrain.
No, listen, hang on. What you're saying, that's what I've said.
Well, you said on current affair.
Well, don't misquote me on quite current affair. I'll answer a question if you've got what I'm at. I own 15% of Terrain. I don't own 35% or 38%. Now, if you don't know the difference between owning 15% and 38% in a business sense, I can't help you.
But you made a big point on a current affair of saying that the 65% of ordinary shareholders would control Terrain. And so they will.
And so they would in a Channel 9 if they wanted to. My point to you is that they don't want to. I am the chairman of Channel 9. Most people are happy with that arrangement.
And you control it, but you're saying that a 3%
difference... I control it because of my shareholding and their goodwill. It's a combination of two things.
It's a question of who has the largest shareholding.
No, it's not. It's a combination of goodwill and shareholding. Now, obviously at 49%, you virtually control regardless of what the public thinks. Not 51%, but 49%, because there's always 1 or 2% who aren't going to bother to vote. But at 38%, I can be voted out of Channel 9. If they like the way I'm doing the job, they won't do it. If they want to vote me out, they can.
Mr. Packer, in answer to a previous question, you quite confidently said that, or asserted that Turing had a superior bid in terms of O'Reilly and AIN.
No doubt that's correct.
And on page 5 in your submission, you stated that firstly what Fairfax needed most was a much lower debt.
Correct.
Now, in that sort of context, can you give us the inquiry some information as to what do you think are Turing's intentions towards the Fairfax superannuation funds?
It will be kept entirely intact.
Entirely intact.
Entirely intact. All the other creditors under the Turing bid will be honoured.
In terms of those funds, did those funds in any way, either formally or informally, with your discussions with Conrad Black, shape the bid
you
that you made?
No, there is a fund there, and I'm not too sure about it either. There's a couple of no. There's no way in the world we're going to go and pilfer money out of the staff funds. Just be told.
What about the track record of Conrad Black? I'm not suggesting your track record, but there is a track record in terms of Conrad Black of actually taking out surplus funds.
You're
not aware
of
that. Can I perhaps read to you just from the last week's Fin Review?
The authority. Fin Review. Right. Let's hear it.
I mean, you can make a comment. I mean, Canadian publisher Conrad Black is a member of the Turing Limited Consortium bidding for Fairfax. In 1986, with the approval of the Ontario Pension Commission, some $38 million in Canadian dollars in surplus funds was withdrawn from the staff pension fund of Dominion Stores. Now, if Conrad Black has that record of pulling them back...
Were they surplus to what was supposed to be there?
They were surplus funds.
So they were not the property of the people in the fund?
But aren't there
Where
some...
they were not the property of the people in the fund.
But can't you also... But you said just a while ago that those that money you wouldn't touch.
You're asking me...
Would you touch the surplus?
...about Conrad Black's behaviour in Canada. I am saying to you his behaviour in Canada was proper. I am also saying to you, when you're asking me here in Australia, that there will be no pilfering of the funds of the company. That's what I'm saying to you.
You wouldn't have any say in it anyway.
No, I don't, you know, there is absolutely no interest, and no part of the bid structure was founded on the basis of taking superannuation funds back from the company.
Well, just taking what you said just a while ago, what about the surplus in those funds?
No part.
No part whatsoever.
That covers the principal, the surplus, everything. No part. It's very precise.
That's precise.
Thank you.
Mr. Sinclair.
We could have a look at the three things that you've spoken about in your opening remarks, Kerry. The first was you talk about the constraints placed upon me by the Broadcasting Act. Yes, you know, Trevor Kennedy resigned essentially because of his apprehension.
You can understand it too, can't you?
Well, I'm not really questioning what Mr. Kennedy did, but I'm curious that the constraints of the Broadcasting Act were essentially behind, as I understand it, Trevor Kennedy's resignation. Are you happy with the provisions in the Broadcasting Act? I mean, perhaps I should say that our real role is to look at the adequacy or not of the laws that apply. Now, have you views about the associate type role that is now
absurd?
So you think that they should be removed from
the... Yes, I do. I think they're absolutely ridiculous. And on that basis, you could nearly knock anybody out any time you ever wanted to.
In fact, they could easily knock out Malcolm Turnbull, couldn't they?
Yes, they could.
So that it makes it very difficult for the Turang company as originally structured really to compete on what you might call equal terms with other companies.
What makes it difficult is that if you go there to put in an unconditional bid, you have conditions which are hanging over from the Broadcasting Tribunal or FARB, and therefore your bid is less likely to be unconditional. Now, I think Malcolm Turnbull will get through that once you have an inquiry. I think you'll get through it. I didn't bring Malcolm Turnbull to this deal, and I think that should be understood. He is an investment banker. On his own behalf, he went off and tied up the junk bondholders, not on my behest.
Well,
he was right, as it subsequently turned out. That is the other key. He went off and did it. I didn't have any arrangements to do any business with Malcolm Turnbull on this implied, real, anything else. Until he turned up and said, here are the junk bond holders. And at that point in time, that's when we sat down and said, all right, well, there's the junk bond holders, there's Helmut Friedman, there's Conrad Black, there's me. All right, let's have a serious go at this thing. And that was really the start of it. It was really in 1991 that, from my point of view, we became serious. Up until then, it had been chit-chat and conversations.
But once the junk bond holders are paid off, there's really no role in for Malcolm Turnbull as an individual, is there?
No, not really, except he wants desperately to be on the board of Fairfax.
But apart from that particular role, the junk bondholders, it's Malcolm Turnbull vis-a-vis anybody else who might have appealed to the shareholders at the time, really.
There is absolutely no reason why Malcolm Turnbull has to remain on the board of Fairfax, no, absolutely none. Are you suggesting it would help the bid if he wasn't there?
I'm suggesting that the powers of the Broadcasting Television Act are something we need to look at, and therefore whether it's an association in one form or another.
Again?
Well, I wondered whether you might have... you suggested they're inadequate, that you didn't agree with them. I wondered if you'd tell us how...
they're inadequate.
I'm sorry. No, but you suggested they need to be changed, and some of the revisions were nonsensical.
I think some of them are absurd. I don't think they're inadequate as such. I think
over-adequate. Well, if they're absurd, have you or your advisers thought about how they should be changed? I mean, as I say, the role of this committee is to look at what the rules are, see whether they should or should not be changed. I'd be interested to know what your views are.
Mr. Sinclair, I would love to get a paper submitted to this inquiry on that very subject.
Would you be prepared to do so?
Of course I would. Better write it.
I think it would be of help to us. Have you any views about the Trade Practices Act? There's a good deal of pontification about the market dominance and other aspects of that act.
I find some of the people who have been parading those views are slightly amusing. The trade practices, I don't own a newspaper anywhere in Australia. Now, how there can be any suggestion that me buying into a newspaper in a 15% capacity in a company which I'm going to have less say than most people in. And by that I mean less say than most shareholders. And how that is going to equate 15% here for the BRW, and 15% of BRW over here, and Australian Business Monthly over here, which I own 100% of. One comes out monthly, one comes out weekly. They are a tiny fraction of the finance market. Every newspaper in the country carries a financial section, which is, over the course of a week, far more significant than those publications. They are, as I say, one monthly, one weekly, and they are completely and absolutely in the total finance market, which is carried by radio, by television, by newspapers, incidental. I mean, any suggestion there's a concentration there, I think, is a nonsense statement. I don't have one newspaper, and that's the only area in the magazine area where there's anything. And if the worst comes to the worst, we'll do something about getting rid of it.
But you'd accept generally that magazines are accepted as a form of print media, and many people think of them as newspapers.
Well,
the Press Council, for example, the chairman this morning told us that he felt they were part of the newspaper article in general.
That?
Well, it was a group with whom I gather you as a proprietor presumably would have had some say when Sir Frank Kitto laid down the terms and conditions way back in the 70s.
I think my father might have been involved at that point in time rather than me. I have never been to the Press Council.
No,
I have never had a service. I have never had a service from the Press Council.
But you've never suggested to the Press Council that magazines should be excluded either, have you?
I haven't bothered to talk about the Press Council much, having been attacked in newspapers for 20 years and having never had the Press Council do one thing about it. I think they're a complete and absolute piece of window dressing.
Right, well, having accepted that role, do you accept that magazines are a form of print media that's commonly seen as part of the newspaper world?
No, I don't. And I have here a notice of the parliamentary inquiry, print media inquiry. And do you know the papers that you put your ads in to get everybody to know about it? The Australian, the Advertiser, the Courier Mail, the Canberra Times, Northern Territory News, Sydney Morning Herald, the Mercury, the Age, the Herald Sun, Melbourne, the Daily Telegraph, the West Australian. There's not one magazine or one publication there which I own which you even bothered to put an ad in. So you don't think much of them either.
We didn't put one on Channel 9 either, though, did we?
Well, it's a print media inquiry here.
Yes, but we've got... Well, you, we're talking about the broadcasting and television legislation. There's cross-media
really,
link-up, isn't it?
If you didn't have broadcasting and television legislation, you'd have no say at all, because constitutionally there's got to be an enormous argument that you have no right to inquire into print media at all.
Foreign Investment Review Board?
15% and it's automatic. What's next?
So you'd legislate so that there'd be 15% and it's automatic, so that there'd be no more than 15% foreign ownership?
No, I'm saying to you that it is that at this point in time that... You don't have to go to the Foreign Investment Review Board if your ownership is under 15%.
No, but there are still approval processes which have changed, not by legislation, but by regulation over the course of time, which have varied both the percentage and the extent to which the FIRB provides a judgment, aren't they?
You've got very clear guidelines. Very clear guidelines. And this is one of the things which I think has really been enormously hurtful to this whole process. You have guidelines, and you have changed them, you've twisted them around in response to pressure from journalists. Now, you know, there are people out there who want to invest in this country, and they want to invest in it because they think it's a stable, decent country. The performance we have seen and the attempted hijackings in this company, in this performance, have taken people who I know over there who are saying, why would anyone invest in Australia? The laws get twisted and changed. The whole structure gets moved round depending on whether they like the colour of your eyes or not. Now, if we were a little bit more worried about jobs out there and getting people to invest money into this country and getting some businesses going instead of trying to stop people, Hellman Friedman represent a group of people in America who are committed to Pacific Rim investment. And the clients that they have are worth some hundreds of billions of dollars. And they are sitting here saying, nobody could carry on like these people. It's not possible. Now, that's the damage you're doing, changing the rules every single day. And I think the people out there whose jobs have been pissed up against the wall don't thank you for it.
Are you saying, Mr. Packer, that you don't think Parliament has the right to inquire into the print media?
Yes, I am saying exactly that.
And so you don't
and
think
you're doing it through the Australian Broadcasting Control Board, and you're not doing it for any other reason.
So you don't think Parliament has the responsibility?
I don't think under the Constitution you have the right to do it.
Can I finish my question?
I'm answering it.
That the National Parliament has the responsibility for looking at any aspect of public policy which it judges to be appropriate?
You seem to be completely unaware of the Constitution of Australia, which you, as a politician, have to abide by the same as everybody else. My view is that under the Constitution, you don't have the right.
Well, the lawyers...
Now, it can go... The lawyers also hold that view almost equally, whether you do or whether you don't. Now, if you really want to, you can go to the High Court and find out.
No lawyer who's come before us has questioned that we have the right to do that.
Maybe you haven't asked them the question.
Well, perhaps before Mr. Sinclair does, perhaps I could just point out that the committee has taken evidence from the Attorney General's Department.
I hardly think they're going to be volunteering it.
Well, in fact, they've advised us that they consider that the National Parliament does have the power to legislate in certain areas, but that doesn't mean that it's right to do so.
No, it doesn't.
But perhaps we'll allow Mr. Sinclair.
I just had a few things I was still pursuing my life. Foreign Investment Review Board, then. You talk about changes, I don't disagree with you. Would you like to see the role, status and the responsibility of the Foreign Investment Review Board legislated, so we know where they were and their decisions published?
As an Australian, I think it would be very helpful if everybody knew what the rules of the game were. And I think if we're going to try to encourage investment into this country, then the clearer we make the rules and the less often that we change them, the better it'll be for this nation.
So somewhere between finding some of the rules are not very acceptable and the fact that they need to be remain there permanently, we've got the position.
Hang on. My complaint about the Foreign Investment Review Board is purely and simply the attempted hijacking of it. In 1986, there was a cross-media ownership laws brought in, which we have complied with in every way, shape and form. Coupled with them was a guidelines on Foreign Investment Review Board, which we've also complied with. And all I'm saying to you is, let's not change them all the time. Let's keep what we've said as the rules. They're the rules. All right, I accept they're the rules, and I accept that they've been made by the Parliament. But what I don't accept is that you can change them every 10 minutes to suit whichever way the wind wants to blow.
No, I accept
that. They are the rules. Stick by them. Let us all go through, abide by those rules.
And you will help people to get round them, won't you? I mean, in evidence to the Costigan Royal Commission, you were asked about a large amount of cash you kept in your safe, and you said they were needed for punting and shares. And when you were asked what shares, you said Oceanic Equity. A friend of mine wanted to get control of that particular company. He was a foreigner. He couldn't get it through the FIRB in that sense. It needed an Australian partner who was prepared to buy shares and hold them. So you can be very helpful, can't you?
Well, I thought those were privileged documents.
I'm sorry. I mean,
that's a bit late, isn't it?
I'm just giving you an example, Mr. Pepper.
You're giving me an example of what?
Of how if people need to get around the FIRB... You're
giving me an example of something that I was exonerated from and hijacked into before, the Costigan inquiry, and you're sitting here under parliamentary privilege, dragging that up again, having been exonerated by the Parliament of this country. I think you've got a damned hide.
I'm sorry, Mr. Packer.
I was not trying to raise that instance, obviously, but I was very interested in what you're saying about the FIRB, because obviously one of the problems we have is the extent to which foreign interests might have a control over the Australian media. Have you a view about that at all?
Look,
apart from Conrad Black, just in general.
What I'm saying to you is that the sort of equity which has been asked to be contributed into Turang's bid is the sort of equity which is dream equity. It has no votes. Yeah, this is the Hellman Friedman. It has no votes, and it only becomes shares, or a form of share or shadow share, in the hands of Australians. Now, the whole world is looking for equity that does, which has so few strings to it. It has less power than somebody who's lent you money. Now, I personally think that you have to be aware of the fact that in the world today, there is an enormous shortage of capital. wherever you go, the thing which is in shortest supply is capital. In America, you've got banks with terrible problems, you've got financial institutions with problems, you've got insurance companies with problems, you've got savings and loans with problems. There is no money out there for companies which are good companies, which have had good relationships with their banks over long periods of time, and they still can't get money. You've got Japan on the other side saying we are contracting, the banks are downgrading, downsizing, we are taking money back into ourselves. All of those things are going on, and the whole world is now competing for capital. I mean, the whole world is competing for it. And I think we have to be aware of that as a nation, and we have to start doing something which encourages capital to be brought into this country. Now, you people know better than I do what you want to do about that. But I think any encouragement, forgetting this transaction, which you can give to people to invest money in Australia, you should look at very seriously. The whole world is trying to encourage money in. We are still sitting there saying, we don't know whether we want it. And I don't think we're that rich anymore.
So you don't think there's really any adverse consequence in terms of overseas ownership of the Australian media? You're not worried about it?
Well, I mean, let's look at it. We've got Rupert Murdoch, the Australian, if you like.
I was going to come back to him in a moment.
Yeah, but I mean, Rupert Murdoch, the Australian. Went to England, was allowed to buy newspapers in England. Went to America, was allowed to buy newspapers in America. Went to Hong Kong, was allowed to buy newspapers in Hong Kong. Went to Australia, was allowed to buy newspapers in Australia. Rupert Murdoch then became an American. He's got papers in Australia. He's got the same thing. Didn't matter about his nationality at all. You've got Conrad Black, Canadian, 150 newspapers in America. Daily Telegraph in England. Jerusalem Post or whatever it is in Israel. Nobody's trying to stop him from owning newspapers anywhere. Absolutely, completely open register. You've got Maxwell owning a paper in America, owning one in England, a check. Now, nowhere in the world, or in the English-speaking world, are you restricted from owning newspapers.
Except
now
Australia.
Here, for some extraordinary reason, we're sitting down and saying, you can only have 20% ownership. It's absurd.
Still, the British apply rules against owning breweries, don't they? Which seem to be a bit extraordinary in the contrast.
Well, I thought that was a trade practices thing where you had two breweries and what they wanted to do was put them together. I think that was a different argument. They had no trouble, those people going over and buying their first brewery.
You did take the same view on television, by the way, that there should be unrestricted foreign ownership of television networks in Australia?
Television has always been a different argument, a government one. You can't buy as a foreigner television stations in America. You can't buy as a foreigner television stations in England. You can't buy as a foreigner television stations in France or the European common market. You can't buy as a foreigner television stations in Australia. Now, I mean, they are two separate issues. The parliaments of all those countries have come to different conclusions in different places.
But what's your view? Do you think we should relax foreign ownership of television networks in Australia?
I don't mind what you do. I'd love you to make it an open slather.
Well, perhaps so, Mr. Packer, just on this question of foreign investment, I take it then you don't agree with the view put forward by Mr. Fraser and AIN at this committee that there's some threat to Australia's national interest if too many of our newspapers are owned or influenced by foreigners.
I don't really think we should take the AIN view as presented by Mr. Fraser too seriously. I think it's pretty transparent myself.
Mr. Fraser's argument, I think, was that Australia would end up seeing the world through foreigners' eyes.
Well, you know, who own the papers in England? The Daily Telegraph's owned by a Canadian. Today is owned by an American. The Sunday Express and the Daily Express is owned by an American. The Mirror is owned by an Englishman who was a Czech. Lord Rothermere is about the only one I can think of who is actually British. The Express was owned by Beaverbrook for 50 years. I mean, the newspapers in England have always been owned by foreigners. Lord Thompson, the whole lot. I mean, it's a nonsense argument. Anyone who knew anything about the subject wouldn't be stupid enough to make the statements that have been made.
I just wanted to look at the News Limited position because the paper that you produced to us talks about your own view of some of the policy issues, and you specifically refer to whether or not this committee spent enough time talking about the 65% of the newspaper market now being enough to qualify as a monopoly, and that there hasn't been enough time really inquiring into how the Fairfax sale is likely to affect News Limited's monopoly. How do you think the Fairfax sale will affect the News Limited's monopoly?
Not at all, regardless of who you sell it to.
And you don't worry about AAP and the any of the access to newsprint or any other of the facets of supply?
All those agreements are still in place with Fairfax.
So that whoever owns Fairfax
has access to all of those
things. Have access to all those things, because they're contractual up to a period of time. Just related to News Limited, you'd be aware of the allegations, I suppose you could call them, by Michael Tilley, a merchant banker from Melbourne, that was substantiated by a fellow called Will Jeffcott, who's also a colleague of Tilley's, and their rebuttal by Malcolm Turnbull with respect to this game plan alleged between yourself and Rupert Murdoch. I wonder whether you'd just confirm it. I know you've confirmed it in other public places that you rebut Mr. Tilley's allegation. I think that's the position, isn't it?
Oh, there's no doubt about that. But I think the misunderstanding which arises there is Mr. Tilley was a seller. Mr. Tilley came to me to sell the West Australian. And it was in his interest to turn around and say to me that Rupert Murdoch was a keen seeker of buying the West Australian. And I said, well, you know, we all know Rupert Murdoch's got no hope of buying the West Australian. I mean, under the restrictive trade practice, there's no way in the world he's going to be allowed to buy the West Australian, the Sydney Morning Herald, the Financial Review, or The Age. So don't start telling me about this. I mean, this is not a great deep, dark secret. What I'm saying to you is he's not a player. And he's not a player because he has absolutely no chance of getting through the necessary regulations to be a player. Now, that's what I said to Mr. Tilley.
Yeah.
Somehow or other, this man who I believe was getting a commission from somebody else to try and sell it, didn't want to sell it. And came back with these rather extraordinary statements. Yes, I deny it absolutely.
Just clarify what you're denying? You're denying that there's any Packer Murdoch game plan for the future of Australian newspapers?
I'm saying blind Freddie can read the game plan. What I'm saying to you is if you want to know what's going to happen to the newspapers in this country, Murdoch's not a player. He's got a full book. He can't buy any more of them. So when you sit down to start to decide who's going to buy the West Australian, who's going to buy The Age, The Herald, and the Financial, you can leave Murdoch out. Not because he doesn't want to buy, but because he's got no way in the world of ever being allowed to. And what I'm saying to you, the suggestion that I am conspiring with Rupert Murdoch and know about his game plan is nonsense. What I'm saying to you is anyone who's got half a wit knows that he's not a player in that game.
But the suggestion is that Murdoch had some capacity to influence Kerry Stokes through the deal he had on the Canberra Times, that was not specifically within the exclusions that provided within the Trade Practices Act, and therefore in the financing that he made available to Kerry Stokes, that he had a capacity to influence future investors, at least in the Canberra Times. Now,
I don't know about the Canberra Times in that way.
You don't believe that sort of an influence you could exercise in any way through some association you had with Turing?
No.
Well, it's just that those assertions seem to be behind some of the allegations made. So you know nothing of the relationship with the Canberra Times, and you have no views that you can...
In the conversations I had with Mr. Tilley, at no point in time was the Canberra Times ever mentioned, thought of, discussed, or even became a side issue. What you're saying is that because of what happened with Murdoch with the Canberra Times, could this apply to Tilley?
That's right.
My answer to your question is very simple. I said to Mr. Tilley, don't try and butter me up and give me a big sales pitch about Rupert Murdoch. He's not a player in this game. And anyone with half a brain knows why he's not a player. Now, the Canberra Times and Rupert Murdoch, and everything, that's another argument. I mean,
there have been various suggestions about divestment, and some people have suggested that because of the extent to which News Limited's monopoly is, as some would allege, pervasive, that there needs to be consideration of divestment. I presume you'd be totally opposed to that, is that correct?
I think the time to decide on whether Rupert Murdoch or News Limited was going to have too many papers was a time some little while back. Having let it through, I don't see that you have any right to take it away from him at this point in time. Now, that's my view. It was my view when people came along with Channel 10 and said Channel 10 should be rolled into Channel 7. It was my view then that the Australian public were entitled to three television networks, not two, although financially it would have been quite beneficial to me to have had Channel 10 and Channel 7 rolled up into one. But I think the public are entitled to a better service than that.
Do you think the Trade Practices Commission should have intervened to stop that takeover of the Herald and Weekly Times? Or do you think the Trade Practices Act should have been different so that it could have stopped it?
No, I don't think the Trade Practices Act should have been different. I think the time, if you were going to do that, was at the time that it was put together. And I think there is another argument in this country which I think we have to come to terms with. We tend to sit down and say we must have a Trade Practices Act, we must stop this, we must stop that. Whereas in every other country which is young and developing and vigorous, what they try to do is get 4 or 5 or 10 big companies big enough to go out into the world and compete. And if you look at Japan or you look at Korea or you look at all these places, what they're trying to do is build companies which are big enough to go on and take on world leaders internationally. We as a country only have one, and that's BHP. And I think there's a lot of effort being directed towards trying to chop people down to size, and I think what you really want is bigger companies, not smaller ones.
I'd like to just ask you a question about cross-media ownership limits. I accept your point that you don't have a difficulty with the principle of cross-media ownership rules. Some of your opponents have pointed the finger at the legal mechanisms that were set up for 2UE as evidence that Kerry Packer has sought to get around those rules. Yeah. And therefore, your assurance now that you won't go beyond 14.9% in Toorang can't be believed. How do you explain that structure that was put together with 2UE?
Well, I can explain it pretty easily. To start with, the people who made the accusations, as usual, distorted the facts. They were not as they spelled them out. 2UE was a problem coming to me. 2UE was part of Channel 9. When I took Channel 9 back, 2UE, the problem existed already. The lawyers went to the Broadcasting Tribunal and explained to the Broadcasting Tribunal the structure which was being put in place 5 weeks before it was done. The Broadcasting Tribunal had no objection to that. They were rather pleased, I suspect, that somebody was actually going to solve the problem, get it sold, and do the thing properly and legally. For years, the argument had been going on with Bond, and nothing had happened. Within 9 months of doing it, the station was sold, and the cross-media laws were preserved. We went to them before the event, and the Broadcasting Tribunal have never said they were unhappy with that transaction. That is a direct misinterpretation, misrepresentation again.
Some people have suggested to this committee that perhaps we need to tighten the cross-media ownership rules.
And why?
And well, they've put forward the argument that if you think there should be a queen of the screen like yourself or a prince of the print like Mr. Murdoch, that allowing 5% one way and 15% the other way is inconsistent.
Well, why don't you make them both 15?
Well, that would solve the inconsistency.
It's just as good a solution as the other. Look,
why do you think the overlap should be as high as 15?
Because I'm not against look, you made the rules in 1986. I didn't try to sneak around the back door or sneak underneath this. These rules were made in 1986. I read the rules, said, what am I allowed to do? And that's exactly what we've done. Now, why do you want to change the rules again? This is the first... What's happened with this operation going on now is exactly what those rules were put in place for. It's the first time it's been used. It's exactly what they were put in place for. And we have obeyed them absolutely. Why do you want to change the rules again? I mean, since I grew up as a boy, I would imagine that through the parliaments of Australia, from the time I was 18, 19 years of age to now, there must be 10,000 new laws being passed. And I don't really think it's that much better place And I'd like to make a suggestion to you, which I think would be far more useful. If you want to pass a new law, why don't you only do it when you've repealed an old one? I mean, this idea of just passing legislation, every time someone blinks is a nonsense. Nobody knows it. Nobody understands it. You've got to be a lawyer. They've got books up to here. Purely and simply to do the things we used to do. And every time you pass a law, you take somebody's privileges away from them.
We'll restrict those that are there. On the far right wing over here, you've got a couple of supporters in there.
Well, I've got some questions on editorial independence, so Mr.
O'Keefe
first.
Could I just finish this series? I hadn't quite finished, if I may. Won't take long.
Is it on this?
No, it's on...
Well, if it's not a new point, we'll go to Mr. O'Keefe first and then come back to Mr. Sinclair.
Mr. Packer, can I preface my questions by saying to you that I do think there has been far too much concentration on personalities in this issue and not enough discussion of the application of policy. So I want to put some questions to you in as dispassionate a way I can about policy. Just about all the witnesses who've been, committed to the question of concentration of ownership have put the view that there is an unhealthy concentration of media ownership in Australia compared to other countries, and they've quoted numerous royal commissions and other bodies around the world that have said there is something precious about having diversity of media ownership. What do you have to say about the concentration of press owner or media ownership in Australia?
Well, I think what you've said to me is that there's a whole lot of people who've come in here with a vested interest and have put forward a story which says you must be against Packer. Now, I think that's what you're saying to me in a very nice way. I don't see that I will control Terang. I don't see that I'll have any influence of any worthwhile nature on Terang at all. And I think the whole argument is a nonsense. I mean, absolute and complete nonsense. Now, your real problem is the fact that Murdoch's got 65%. What you need is someone very strong to take him on and make sure that he doesn't get any more. Have you had a look at what's happened to media ownership in this country? You've had newspapers, two in Sydney, cease to exist, The Sun and The Mirror. You've had one in Melbourne, two in Melbourne, isn't it? Two or one in Brisbane. The Sun, is The Sun still published up there?
Yeah.
Yeah. The Morning?
Certainly there are some suggestions that it's in difficult, it's not making a profit at the moment. I think that's the suggestion.
But you've lost the Telegraph up there, haven't you?
Yes.
You go to Melbourne, you've lost the Melbourne Herald. Look, there's no divine right for newspapers to continue forever. I mean, they're a business like any other business, and they will be closed down eventually if they become unprofitable. It is very important that you have good management, good people, and people who have got the financial wherewithal to make those papers live and survive.
Well, if I hear what you're saying, you reject the view of the people who have submitted to us and elsewhere that the preservation of diversity of media ownership in some way is essential to the operation of
I think what I'm rejecting is the suggestion that my involvement is going to lessen the diversity of media ownership.
Well, I think you would have to admit that it's axiomatic that if you buy 15% of Fairfax as a media owner in Australia, there is in fact an added concentration of ownership by you doing so.
No, I wouldn't admit it for one moment.
Well, you don't own any of a newspaper at all at the moment.
Yeah, and at the end of owning 15% of Fairfax, from an effective control point of view, I'm no further ahead. Okay. I don't accept it at all, and that's the whole point of my argument.
And I know you've made that argument very strongly on all occasions and in your submission. Can I go secondly to the question of cross-ownership, which you were just discussing a minute ago with the chairman? You are perfectly correct to say that the rules were laid down in 86, they've been there since 86, and you're entitled to make a bid consistent with those rules, and it's unfair to change those rules now. I accept that argument from you.
Good.
I have come to the conclusion personally, from all the evidence I've heard at this inquiry and elsewhere, that any cross-ownership is more trouble than it's worth.
So well, I certainly... You're not one of the people involved in it directly.
Absolutely, and so I put to you that even people with quite disparate interests have said to this committee...
What sort of people? I'm really asking is, who are we talking about?
As broad ranging as Mr. Cowley, for instance, from News Limited, mm-hmm. who may well like the opportunity to invest further in other media.
I'm sure he would.
Through to people such as the AJA and the Communications Law Centre have all argued, and many people have across the spectrum, have argued that if you are going to have cross-media rules, then you might as well make them very clear and very succinct and have no overlap.
Well, if you have no overlap, you don't have to have any cross-media rules. So, but if you're saying to me, would I object to newspapers being allowed to own 15% of a television station? Not at all.
No, so, you're arguing, in fact, that there ought to be some limited overlap, and you're saying that 15% doesn't or shouldn't cause concern to people.
Absolutely, because I don't believe 15% has any control factor whatsoever. Okay. And what's more, the laws of this country, everywhere you go as a parliament, you turn around and say, well, we're not going to let you control this, we're going to restrict you to 15%. And that's what okay. you keep saying in every other act. Fine.
Yeah, I wanted you to have the opportunity to say whatever you feel about it. I'm just telling you the view that I have about it.
Sure.
I think in terms of the Terang bid, much of this comes down to, and will come down under examination, I guess, to what whoever makes the decision perceives to be the relationship between yourself and Mr. Black.
Hang on. I have applied with the law. When you talk about making the decision, the decisions have been made. What you have to make a decision on is whether you're going to change the law.
There's no question. There's no question.
You have to decide whether I'm a liar or whether I'm not. I'm telling you, I'm not going to do it.
There's absolutely no question in my mind that you have complied absolutely with the law in the structure of the Terang bid. Your bid is below 15%. That's all that's asked of you. What the law does also require examination of, though, is whether there is any direct or indirect control that is further involved in that. And you're saying there's not, and I accept your statement on that. What I want to ask you is this. In your approach to this, you've said that Mr. Black is proposing to hold 20%. As far as you understand, it's 20%. I've heard others saying in the last week or so that it's going to be 15%.
I think it's 15% initially and going to 20% with the Foreign Investment Review Board's approval. But the only way you can make an unconditional submission at this stage is 15%. Now, if the Foreign Investment Review Board, in their wisdom, decide after that they don't want him to go, then he won't be able to go up. So he is making a submission of 15% because it's under the Foreign Investment Review Board, and he will probably go back to the Foreign Investment Review Board because he doesn't want to make a conditional submission and say, I'd like to go to 20. And they, at that point in time, have the right to say yes or no.
Now, in respect of...
Sorry, could I just interrupt? What happens if they say no?
He's at 15%.
So an extra 5% gets floated to the public? Is that the idea?
Presumably, yes. I mean, well, the answer is yes. I mean, I wouldn't imagine they would say no because that's the rule. But if they do, then 70% of the shares in the company are floated to the public.
Thank you.
Instead of 65.
Mr.
O'Keefe. The question of the bondholders, the junk bondholders and Mr. Turnbull.
Yeah.
I know, and you say in your submission, you're not wedded to the idea that Mr. Turnbull ought to be a member of the board. Or it might have been Mr. Black said that. I don't know who said it. But the point I'm getting to here is it proposed in the Terang structure that the bondholders will be directly represented on the board, presumably by Mr. Turnbull?
No, that's not the suggestion at all.
So how does their interest
become reflected? Well, I thought it was pretty clearly spelled out that Mr. Turnbull, he went out there and got the junk bondholders signed up, right? Now, one of the things he wanted in return was to be appointed a director of Fairfax's. Not to represent the junk bondholders, but in his own right.
So it is proposed that he will be one of the directors?
It's his proposal, yes.
Well, how do you feel about it?
Doesn't make any difference what I feel about it, old son. I don't have any say.
Okay.
That's my problem. I'm sitting here copying all the crap with no say.
I understand that. Now, in terms of your having no say...
Yes.
And I guess what you're asking us, and you'll have to convince the Tribune or whoever.
I'm not going to convince anybody. This is my first and last appearance on the subject.
As far as this, we're concerned, yes. What you're asking us to accept is that in investing $80 million...
Can I just say one thing? I'm not asking you to accept. I'm saying to you, you must be prepared to prove otherwise. I am telling you unequivocally what my situation is. Now, if you want to take me to court, which is where we'll end up, you'd better be able to prove that what I'm saying is telling you is untrue. And you can't prove that because it's not untrue.
Mr. Packer, I'm simply...
No, I'm not having to go at you. All I'm really trying to do is make it clear that, you know, I've said it so many times, people... I'm not on trial here.
No, and
I know, know that, but the people who are watching this may be under the impression that I've committed some offence. Hmm. And all I'm saying to you is I haven't committed an offence.
No, and there's certainly no inference here in my questions that you have. But what I'm asking you to respond to are lots of points that are put, and one of them, and I think it's a serious one, is you are saying that with an investment of $80 million in this show, which is what you've said in your submission is the amount involved, that you will have no indirect ability to ring up Conrad Black and work through whatever changes you think are needed in the operation.
I have said not once, but now 50 times, I do not have any agreements whatsoever. Of course I can ring up Conrad Black. Whether he listens to me or not, it's entirely up to Conrad Black. Are you suggesting I shouldn't have the right to talk to people? That Conrad Black goes to a cocktail party and I'm over there in England, I see him in the same... I've got to run out of here so that I'm not in the same room as Conrad Black? Of course I can talk to him. I'm still allowed to do that.
Well, no but one's whether suggesting
I have,
you're not.
I have... Pardon?
No one's suggesting you're not. The question about this is that at 14.9%, you have chosen an investment.
The law that is very precise.
Absolutely, but you've chosen an investment that is right up against the rubber band, right up against the boundary line. If you'd chosen a 10% investment, a 7.5% investment, one could not question whether...
You can't be serious with this line of questioning.
What I'm asking you is, how do you refute the question that your 14.9% of direct investment doesn't in fact amount to indirect influence and control in excess of 14.9%. That is the question that has to be answered.
No, it's the question you keep on asking me. It's the question I keep on answering, and you don't like the answer. The answer is very clear. If I do what you're suggesting I can do, I break the law. I'm not prepared to break the law. Mm-hmm. Now, how many times have I got to goddamn tell you?
Mr. Packer, are there any other companies where you have a 15% interest where you don't have a director chosen by you or anything like that?
Doesn't own anything.
Yeah.
Which are they?
Well, I own 50% of TV Week and I have no say in anything.
And no one representing your interests?
None at all. 50% and no say at all.
So the argument that Mr. Packer is never a passive shareholder does not hold weight. Is that
incredibly wrong?
Could I ask, Mr. Packer? Can I go back to not back across that ground? One other question that you discussed with Mr. Sinclair, which I had on my list to ask you about. It has been submitted to us that magazines ought to be considered as part of the print area.
Submitted to.
Oh, you'll be able to check the transcripts.
I don't want to check the transcript. You're asking me a whole lot of questions. I'm just asking you one thing. Who submitted to it? Who submitted that to you?
A number of bodies appearing before us. I can't recall them all now.
The vested interests, okay?
Okay, but they've put the view that magazines ought to be included as part of the concept of print media. If in fact it were to be included, then it would mean that by definition, Murdoch's 65% or whatever it is would be reduced because your participation in the caper actually increases diversity.
Listen, Murdoch's 65% relates to newspapers. Now, if you're seriously sitting here and saying you've had a whole lot of people coming up here and telling you that magazines are newspapers, then you've really wasted a lot of the taxpayers' money and time, because you really should be sophisticated enough to know the difference between a magazine and a newspaper.
Now,
65% of Murdoch's reach, it relates to newspapers. Yes, yes. That is the figure. It's got nothing to do with magazines. And whatever you do to magazines over on the other side, that figure won't change.
What I'm asking you is, and the Trade Practices Commission before us, for instance, has said to us that they view print as a defined market. That just happens to be their view, right? The word print, P-R-I-N-T, in their view, includes newspapers and magazines, because they said print is print.
Right.
That's how they define it.
People is women and men.
Do you have problems with that as a definition?
Yes, I do.
Why?
Well, I have real problems with it because, as I say to you, if you turn around and say people, that means women and men, but there's no difference between men and women, then I think it's a nonsense argument. You're saying print, I'm saying there's a big difference between magazines and newspapers. I'm saying there's a big difference in people between men and women. Now, you really can't turn around and just say, I'll use a generic title for everything, and expect to get away with that argument. Restrictive trade practices, what it's got to do, what the Sydney Morning Herald's got to do with the Woman's Weekly is beyond my comprehension. And how they compete against one another is beyond my comprehension. I think it's an absolute nonsense.
Some people have argued that magazines are so influential that they should perhaps be treated as a fourth arm in the cross-media ownership rule.
We're here again today rewriting the rules again, because one person's had the effrontery to actually obey your rules to the letter and to the spirit of your rules and has gone exactly along the line that you meant to. Now you want to change all the rules again.
So I take it you're against magazines being a fourth arm show. Okay. Mr. O'Keefe?
I was going to ask you to comment on one other comment.
Right.
Paddy McGuinness was here before us. I'll tell you who it was. It was Paddy McGuinness. was here before us the other day, and he said, this is a paraphrase. He said, I don't know what you're all worried about Mr. Packer for. He won't be here in 5 years. He alluded to your health condition and said this was all out of context. And in fact, you've said something similar. Not the 5-year prognostication.
I'm hoping for longer than that.
He's got his bid in on that one.
He knows what it feels like.
You think
like.
We should be listening? You think there's some merit in what Paddy had to say?
I think it's a storm in a teacup. I mean, I think what's happened is whether Conrad Black is in charge of John Fairfax and Sons for the next 10 years or whether he's not, in the overall scheme of things, I don't think it matters a damn. The papers are good papers, they'll continue to run, they'll have some disciplines brought to them, they'll have an improved balance sheet, they'll have the capacity to fight, and they will go on in their own way. Are we really suggesting that under the stewardship of the Fairfaxes for 150 years, that those papers were always under great owners and great leaders? Have you ever had a look at the Fairfax family? You're talking about David Syme as if it's some reverent operation. There was never a more interventionist owner in the history of newspapers in this country than the old man Syme. I mean, it's all claptrap. Let's get on with it. Let's get it finished. What's more important is the papers are well, that they're nurtured, they're looked after, they're financed properly, and they have the opportunity to go out there and compete heavily against News Limited, which is a very strong, very tough competitor everywhere in the world. And you need some people in there who've also got the experience and the money and the desire to compete. And I think there's a consortium of people put together there who will do that. And I think you'd be very lucky to have them. Conrad Black runs a fantastic newspaper. That's why he was there. He's used to running quality newspapers. And it's a great paper. You know, even his enemies would say it's a great paper. Probably the best quality daily paper in England.
And certainly better than the Fairfax Press here, you'd say. You said on television they need a lot of needs a lot of fixing, the Fairfax papers.
I will... If you look at the amount of space which has been devoted to this rather petty argument about who owns John Fairfax and Sons, you will see why I say they need fixing. The balance in those papers is appalling. I'm not talking about the balance of whether they like Packer or don't like Packer. I'm talking about the decision, the basic decision, to spend the amount of space and time on this story that has been spent. The public don't think it's that important. They really don't give a damn. There's a lot more important subjects out there for them, one of which is jobs. I mean, this is an intellectual wank is going on here.
Perhaps I could turn to something which you might describe in similar terms, and that's just the whole question of editorial independence. And I'm just wondering, as a magazine proprietor, what independence you give the editors who produce your magazines?
Look, what are we talking about? Are we talking about the charter, or are we talking about the AJA code of ethics?
Well, I'm just wondering what independence you give your editors.
I believe that owners have the right to interfere in the running of a newspaper or in the running of a magazine. I make no bones about that. They pay the bills. And one of the funny things that's happening at the moment is I'm just suing some Fairfax journalists because of what they've said in the Friends of Fairfax. And now they're discovering the joys of being owners. They're going to actually have to pay these legal costs themselves. Now, for years, they've been sitting there writing whatever they like, and when the bills come in, they just hand them over the road. This time, they're going to get the bills and have to pay them themselves. If you're an owner, you have a responsibility to make sure that the publication is responsible and does certain things. You don't have the right to go and get a hold of a reporter here and say, change that story where the crowd was 20,000, make it 2,000, do this, that, and that. Columnists write their own view. And columnists, I look on an owner rather like a columnist. If an owner wants to send a letter to a newspaper, I think he's entitled to be published. I think his view is entitled to be heard. In an editorial, whatever you like. I don't subscribe for one moment to people changing actual facts to suit their own situation. So I believe proprietors have the right and the responsibility to see that their newspapers are good and accurate and try to be fair and balanced. That's my belief. If you're saying to me that do I subscribe to the code of ethics from the... I get confused. The charter, I think, is an absolute nonsense. That's trying to hijack the owner's situation without paying the bills. I mean, it's a joke. If you're talking about the code of the AJA code, I think that's a first-class set of rules. There's a couple more rules I'd probably put in there, but I believe the weakness in that is that you have the journalists talking to their union and saying what they're going to do. And I believe that that really should be between the paper and the journalists. And when people become journalists on a newspaper, I think they should be turning around and saying, hang on, these are the rules by which you will operate. This is what we expect you to do in your reporting in this newspaper. And if you fail to do that, this newspaper will penalise you for not doing it.
So you have no problem with an agreement between the journalist, the editor, and the proprietor?
There's one thing in there that I would take out. I might add a couple more things to it. So the age charter, I think, is an absolute nonsense.
Some people have said that the fact that you dismissed David Dale is evidence that you're an interventionist proprietor, and that's why they're concerned about Kerry Packer owning more in print. Would you care to respond to that argument?
Well, I mean, David Dale has made a career out of being dismissed by me. In 15 years of running quite a lot of magazines, I think I've fired one editor, David Dale. And do you know why I fired him? I was asked in an interview in the Bulletin about an article that appeared in the Bulletin before, which was Australia's 100 Most Appalling People, I think it was called. And this was a list of people which was made up by David Dale and some other people, not on any basis of fact, not on any basis of research or anything. This was, oh, he'd be fun to make appalling, wouldn't he? Oh, what about him? Oh, probably the boss likes him, so we'll put him in. I mean, this 100 people were blackened in the Bulletin by this editor. Fine, that happened. I was asked in an interview for the Bulletin whether I approved of that, because I'd been very critical about journalistic standards. And I said, no, I don't approve of it at all. I think it's appalling. I think it shouldn't have happened. And what's more, it won't happen again. Fine. Fine. So then I got hold of the editor-in-chief and I said, have you seen what I said here? Now you make sure that article doesn't appear again. 6 months later, it appears under a different name. David Dale thought he'd just put his fingers up my nose and say, to hell with it. Well, you know, having got a direct instruction, unequivocal, completely and absolutely above board, he decided to go the other way. He paid the price. And I make no apologies for that at all. And if he did it again, and he was employed by me, he'd have the same result.
Now, I think under the age, under most of the charters I've seen, the proprietor has the right to hire and fire editors.
Under the Turing arrangement, I am not a proprietor. Please understand that I am talking about my publications.
Yes, that's what I'm talking about at the moment, your publications.
Turing, I've got no say in it.
Okay, so I accept that point that we're just talking about your publications. When Trevor Kennedy...
What I think you did say to me is one of the things that are against me is that I'm an interventionist proprietor, therefore I shouldn't be allowed to be part of Turing because I may interfere. That's the implied thing. I'm saying to you, I can't interfere in Turing, and what I am in my own right is not has no bearing on Turing.
I'm simply saying these are some of the arguments used to argue that Packer shouldn't be allowed to invest in newspapers. When Trevor Kennedy appeared before this committee back in early October, Mr. Kennedy made the statement that articles had appeared in the Bulletin at your suggestion. And I'm wondering I think he made the comment that he disagreed with them or he had some reservations about them. Do you think a proprietor should have the right to get articles put in his publications?
Well, I've got news for you. There's lots of articles that appeared in the Bulletin that I've got reservations about too. Nothing to do with me putting them in there, but they've been put in by editors. I think a proprietor has every right to put forward his point of view. Just because he's a proprietor doesn't make him automatically a moron or without a point of view. He is entitled, after spending years and years in the industry, to have a point of view and to put it, just as entitled as a journalist. Journalists seem to be under the impression that the only people who have any point of view which is worthwhile is themselves. There are other people who are entitled to have a point of view, and sometimes even they stumble across the odd acorn.
So,
a good example of that would be the Conrad Black story on the cover of the Bulletin.
I don't know, you'd have to ask Mr. Kennedy about that. I wasn't in the country.
But some people would perhaps argue that times have changed and the proprietors now have less say than they used to.
They don't have the money in the business.
We're
always being judged by people who have no involvement. We're always being told that this is the way it should be run. As long as they don't have their own money in there and they don't have the responsibility of having the shareholders' funds in there and people haven't followed them on the market and said, we want you to run it, they're always those people who say that you shouldn't do this and you shouldn't do that.
But it'd be fair to say, wouldn't it, that you exercise less influence over your publications than your father exercised over the Daily Telegraph?
That would be very fair to say.
Didn't you make the point on A Current Affair that your father exercised real power, because it has been suggested before I was born that he used to have quite a strong involvement on the copy that appeared in that paper?
No doubt he did. I mean, I sat at home for year after year and hearing him dictate editorials. The truth of that. And I am not ashamed of that in any way, shape or form. Why shouldn't he? They were editorials, they weren't news stories, and he was entitled to put his point of view. I don't happen to want to do that, and I don't do it.
But do you think these days that would be improper for proprietors?
No, I don't think it would be improper at all. I mean, I don't see any reason at all why one group of people over here are the recipients of all the wisdom and all the right thoughts, and the other group over here, which is the proprietors, are all wicked, evil men who shouldn't have their point of view put forward. I don't know who anointed the journalists to the position of being Christs.
Would it be improper of you to try and ensure that articles appearing in the Bulletin didn't criticise your own financial interests?
Listen, nobody has been criticised by their own publications and TV stations more than I have. I was accused by Mr. Willesley of committing murder on Channel 9 during the Costigan affair. What happened to Mr. Willesley? Did he get sacked? Did he get stopped? Don't talk to me about stopping people writing stories about me. I've had more of it than any of you, and I'm supposed to be in a position to stop it. But yet I never have. Judge me on my record, not on what people tell you they think it's going to be. I've been around for a long time. Bring me the situations where I've interfered and done the wrong thing. Present them to me.
Now, I'm not suggesting that you have. I'm simply saying to you, do you think it would be improper if a proprietor sought to do the things that you've just discussed?
No, I don't think it's improper if a proprietor does it within the terms of how he should do it, which is in the form of an editorial or in the form of a letter. I think he has every right to put his point of view like anybody else does.
But do you think it would be improper for a proprietor to require a journalist to mislead the readers in the
I think that's very wrong, but I've always thought that's wrong. And show me one occasion in which I have ever done it.
Okay. I think we have Mr. Sinclair, Mr. Charlesworth, and Mr. Langwell. Mr. Sinclair.
How much more time will we
have? Can I just take up that issue and put it around the reverse? You've been critical of the campaign which has been waged in the Fairfax columns against you.
Not critical in the past tense, still critical.
Still critical, and may I say, I agree that there has been a campaign, but with the view you have of proprietal non-interference, what you're putting to this committee is it would have been no different if you'd owned it.
Would have been different in the sense that the people putting that point of view are employees of the paper trying to stop themselves from having a new owner. Yeah. What I'm talking about is as the proprietor, as the person who pays the bills, as the person who is finally responsible, as the person under the law who has to pay their libel actions, as that person, I think you have more rights than that of an employee. You don't agree with me?
No, it's not quite the point I'm making. You've just been putting, I think, to the chairman a view that you have a policy of proprietal non-interference, and I'm turning that around to say...
That's not what I put to you at all. What I'm saying to you is I believe a proprietor has the right to intervene. I don't happen to do it.
All right.
But that doesn't mean I don't have the right to do it.
No, I'm not questioning your right. I'm saying, as I think I rightly understood, that you're putting to the chairman that you don't believe a proprietor should intervene. I'm turning it around the other way and saying that we couldn't have expected any better from the Fairfax Press if you'd owned it during this whole period.
I'm sorry.
Right?
I think, and maybe I'm misunderstanding you, but I think you're saying that I hold a view that proprietors shouldn't intervene. Is that what you're saying?
That you hold the view proprietors shouldn't influence what goes into columns.
News stories, not editorials or letters to the editor.
That's as I understand it.
I'm saying that a proprietor has the right to put into an editorial his point of view or the right to write a letter to his publication.
Yes.
I'm not talking about not being an interventionist. I'm talking about he has that right. Now, whether he chooses to use it or not is up to him.
But you also say that you personally choose not to influence what stories are reported and how the stories are reported.
That's true.
And so I'm really turning it around and saying, if you had owned the Fairfax Press during this campaign, the way in which the campaign has been waged against you wouldn't have been affected one iota.
That's not accurate. Because what you're saying to me is that I wouldn't have taken no action after the event. And I would have taken an action after the event. I believe journalists, like everybody else and editors, have to be prepared to argue their case after the event. I think your proprietor is perfectly entitled to turn around and say to somebody, you put this story in. Why did you say this? Where is your proof for what you're saying, what you're claiming? Now, if a journalist isn't capable of arguing that successfully, then he shouldn't be a journalist. I'm not trying to stop what he says, but I am trying to make sure that he understands that he can't just say anything and go away scot-free. He has to be able to prove what he says.
Well, then, let's suppose that the Fairfax Press started running the campaign in the way that it has against you. You had gone to the journalist. You had put your case. Would that campaign have ended earlier had you been the proprietor? Would it have ended now?
We keep coming back to the Fairfax Press. We keep on pretending that my voice is going to be significant in this. I keep on saying to you that I have no voice in the Fairfax Press.
I agree with that.
I will have no voice in the Fairfax Press.
I agree with that. I'm testing your view.
You're testing everything.
I'm testing your view of what you would have done
and
your view
anything.
Of proprietorship.
I am not the proprietor of John Fairfax, and I am never destined to be the proprietor of John Fairfax.
I mean, I agree with you. I think a terrible campaign has been waged against you. What I'm trying to feel is what you would have done about it, and what you seem to be saying is you would have done something, but...
What I'm saying to you is judge me on my record about campaigns that have been against me in the past. I am not the proprietor of John Fairfax. I am not about to become the proprietor of John Fairfax. In my own publication, I would go to somebody and say to them, why do you say this? What is your reason for making this allegation?
Suppose it's a weak reason.
Then I would say, do you really think that's justified what you've said?
Mm-hmm.
And I would hope that the next time he comes to write an article, he would bear that in the back of his mind, that there's a chance that somebody will turn around to him again and say, can you justify this? In other words, will it stand any form of light at all? And if it won't stand any light, it shouldn't get written. If it will stand light, go right ahead.
Dr. Charlesworth?
Can I just finish? I haven't pursued these other lines I was after before, have I? You on that same point, Rick?
No, I'm not on that point. I'm on something else.
Well, I've got a couple that flow a little from that, if I may. One is that... you've said that the Fairfax Group are really in their position because they're in receivership. They're in a financial mess. You've said that the link with Conrad Black was that he runs good newspapers. I mean, you've commented very favourably on those. Yeah. Presumably, by running good newspapers, it means that it has financial control and strong editorial direction, presumably in the way that you've asserted. All those things you'd see the Fairfax Group newspapers requiring.
I don't know how he controls editorially. I don't have a clue. I've never asked him.
No, but the result is he runs good newspapers and they're regarded as great newspapers, and that's been one of the reasons you thought he was a good partner, presumably.
Yeah.
If it weren't for the cross-media ownership, you would have still presumably been interested in John Fairfax.
Yes.
Would you have sought something over the 15%?
Yes.
And you'd still, if there were to be an increase, consider that as a proposition that it'd be, for all the reasons you've given, something that you might wish to pursue?
Probably not now.
Why not now?
The fight's not worth the effort.
I would have thought that the end result of getting the Fairfax Group as a good competitor for News Limited was still something that you've got to...
There are other things in my life which I would prefer to do. Yeah. I mean, I would not have gone as far as I've gone in this thing if I'd realised how controversial it was going to be to begin with. Having become controversial, I am not prepared to be rolled over in what I consider to be an unjust cause. But I'm not really that interested. There are other things I would prefer to do. If I had the opportunity, I would still be in partnership with Conrad Black. I may have 20%, I may have 15%. I would have liked to have been on the board and had some say in the matter, but I don't really want to run it.
But if Conrad Black doesn't live up to expectations...
He'll get replaced.
He will get replaced. You would not think of either intervening or selling his shares. You, as an individual.
I mean, I may well sell my shares. But I can't intervene. All I can do is vote with everybody else. That may be enough to replace him. It may not be enough to replace him. I don't know. But presumably, the people who have been shareholders or will be shareholders in Fairfax will be sophisticated enough this time round to take an active interest in how that paper is managed.
I suppose one of the reasons many of us sort of look at 15% and see it as having more influence than you've suggested is that we had a thing called an 8-6 vote in Malcolm's cabinet, and if Malcolm felt one way, it somehow meant that he had more votes than anybody else. And strong management really means that.
And there's no doubt at Consolidated Press I've got an 8-6 vote too. But at Fairfax, I don't get a vote.
You don't get a vote?
No, and to be perfectly honest, I don't really want one. I'm quite happy. I'm not happy being told I can't have it. I'm not happy being bullied at the last moment and being manipulated. But I'm quite happy not to have a vote.
Because to a degree,
there are other things I prefer to do.
Do you think it's fair to say that AIN are making the most of their Australianness in order to talk down the price and so secure for themselves a better chance?
I don't think ANI are in the event.
Yeah, but the suggestion I'm making, I suppose, is that they're suggesting that in some way foreign ownership is evil, therefore they should be favoured, and that would secure for themselves a lower price if in fact that was the position that the government took.
Their whole case is based, as you rightly say, on the capacity to buy it cheap. They are saying, if you knock out the foreign ownership, if you knock out Packer, then you come back to us as the only alternative and we'll buy it at the price which makes it a gift.
And then they intend to float it and perhaps make a nice...
Well, I think that's probably a little hard in the sense that I think the institutions will probably be the shareholders rather than the board of directors. And I don't know that the board of directors are going to go make a great deal of money out of it. The institutions, obviously, only ever buy shares because they think they're going to make money out of it.
Is it the case, though, that when you bought back Channel 9, it was restrictions on foreign media ownership which were reinforced by the government, which in fact assisted you in the purchase of that?
How do you mean assisted me? Well, you start off assuming I wanted it back. I sold it to get rid of it. I wouldn't have to sit here and listen to this bloody broadcasting argument if I didn't have it.
Well, someone twisted your arm to buy it.
Certainly they twisted my arm. I had $200 million in there, which was going up the flue if I didn't buy it back. I got out of the television business because I didn't want any more of it.
I assumed that you bought back because it was a good investment.
I bought back because I had to buy back. I had no choice. I was the only one there who could get it back and get my money back. Didn't buy it back because I wanted it, for God's sake.
So this is an option for you to...
I'm back there now. I've got it. I've spent a year at it. It's going very well. It's a good station. It's got good management. It's got good people. I don't have to do so much work on it anymore. It's fine. But I'm not contemplating selling it, but please don't misunderstand why I took it back. I took it back because I had money in there, which was going back. When I took it back, it was bankrupt. When I took it back, it owed $700 million. I mean, both the other stations went bankrupt, and this one, in reality, was also bankrupt. If I hadn't converted my debt, it would have been bankrupt.
If there hadn't been a foreign ownership limit, do you think a foreign owner would have been interested in buying Channel 9?
Well, they went hawking it round to every foreign owner that ever was there. They were all going to do this and going to do that. And I kept on holding my breath and saying, come on, get up to the line, put the money down. No, they all evaporated. And I got left with it.
I can't imagine you being left holding the baby.
Well, I got left holding that baby.
Can you tell us why Mr. Kennedy resigned?
He didn't want to go through this sort of nonsense any longer.
Just because of the pressure and...
Not the pressure, it's the Australian Broadcasting Tribunal. I mean, it's all in his statement. I really can't comment on it any more than that.
Last question is Mr. Langmore.
Mr. Packer, it's been shown before this committee that when Kerry Stokes bought the Canberra Times from Australian Consolidated Press, that News Limited provided finance for that. Was there any News Limited involvement or was there an undertaking to News Limited of any kind when Consolidated Press owned the Canberra Times that they might be able to buy it under certain circumstances?
Unfortunately, there wasn't any undertaking. I mean, I bought it in a package and tried very hard to sell it to everybody. And News Limited was the first people I went to. But unfortunately, they couldn't buy it.
Okay. Is Australian Consolidated Press controlled in Australia or overseas?
You're the only bloke who gets a cup of tea.
I'll
get one
for you, I'm sure.
Well,
I'm
working hard here.
You're doing very well, Adam.
I can't even get a cup of tea.
What do you like? What do you like? White or black?
White with lots of sugar.
Well, there we are.
Thank you very much.
Tea or coffee?
Coffee would be wonderful if it was there. Thank you. Sorry.
That's all right. It's
you might get more questions.
Keep the sugar levels up.
Yeah, I'm not wrong.
You might get more questions now. You might be coming up with Mr. Langwell.
I think we're over time now, aren't we?
We are. Yeah, Mr. Langwell.
Is Australian Consolidated Press controlled in Australia or overseas?
Controlled wherever I am.
Well, are you based in Australia?
I am an Australian citizen. I am here. I pay Australian tax. I do the whole lot.
Are some of the Consolidated Press companies or trusts based overseas?
Yes.
Is it true, as the Four Corners program
Well, virtually suggested? Nothing in Four Corners was true, so the chance of you getting a good answer here are pretty slim.
Is it true, as they suggested, that the accruals tax measures don't apply to your offshore companies and trusts?
Listen, I'm not going to sit here and go through my tax arrangements with you or anybody else. I am advised by the most eminent tax firm in this country, an accounting firm in this country. They do all my tax. They pay whatever tax I'm due to pay under the law, not a penny more, not a penny less. What your, Four Corners story is trying to suggest is that I'm evading tax. I am not evading tax.
No, it wasn't trying to.
What the Four Corners story was trying to say, which you quoted, was that I was evading tax. I have not been evading tax, and I am not evading tax. I pay what I am required to pay. Now, what people don't understand is that there are businesses outside of Australia which have never been historically taxed in Australia. They are nothing to do with Australia. They are businesses that I own in other countries, in the United States of America. Why Australia believes it's entitled to tax that company is beyond my comprehension, but they do. But that is only started from this year.
What the Four Corners program suggested was not that you were evading tax at all, that would have been libelous, but that you were minimising tax.
There's nothing wrong with minimising tax. I don't know anybody who doesn't minimise their tax.
And that you were doing so in ways that were contrary to the spirit of the law.
Oh. Well, I just got through telling you what I thought about that. And what you're saying is exactly what the Four Corners program says. I am not evading tax in any way, shape or form. Now, of course I am minimising my tax, and if anybody in this country doesn't minimise their tax, they want their heads rent. Because as a government, I can tell you, you're not spending it that well that we should be donating extra.
We've just been through a decade debating the difference between evasion and minimisation.
Well, good, because I haven't spent a lot of time on it.
And the outcome of that has been a great tightening, and one of those ways in which the tax laws were tightened was to do with the use of tax havens. Is it true that Australian Consolidated Press pays about 10 cents in the dollar in tax? For example, between 87 and 90, that the profits of Australian Consolidated Press were $620 million and that tax paid was $64 million?
I don't know. Your story, you go ahead with it.
You don't know?
No, I don't know. I don't do the tax returns.
It seems a surprising thing that with your own company, you don't know how much tax you pay.
Well, I don't.
So what would you estimate?
Surely you must sign a director's report or some sort of thing to the shareholders testifying to the company's...
Why? It's a private company.
Oh, fair enough. It's not a public company. Okay, I accept that.
What do you estimate to be
I don't estimate anything.
What do you think, then, is the...
I don't think about it, either.
You mean you're not prepared to answer questions on this subject?
I've already given you the answer on this subject. I've told you that I pay whatever tax I'm required to pay under the law, not a penny more, not a penny less, and the suggestion that I'm trying to evade tax, which is what you're putting forward, I find highly offensive, and I don't intend to cooperate with you in the blackening of my character. Now, you ask whatever questions you like, but my memory's gone.
I thought that someone of your capacity would be able to understand the difference between evasion and minimisation.
I understand it perfectly.
I think Mr. Elliott has a question.
I haven't quite finished. The central criticism, I expect, of your bid for Fairfax is not to do with you or your companies. It is simply that many people believe that enough is enough, that with one television channel and a network and with a great many magazines, that to extend further into the other arm of the print media is to increase the concentration of power more than is warranted. Do you have any sympathy with that point of view? Can you understand? I mean, I presume you do understand it, but I mean, do you have any recognition of the reason why people may feel that way?
I told you that 15% controls nothing, and I don't accept the point of view at all that it does. Therefore, if you don't accept the point of view that 15% controls, then it doesn't diminish the amount of media diversity that's there.
Control isn't the only issue, though.
I mean, AMP Society's got shares in Channel 9, in News Limited, in every print media company there is. It's only the level of shares they have which makes them acceptable or unacceptable. And your law says 15% is acceptable.
So you don't accept this general proposition that enough is enough?
No, I certainly don't accept what you're putting forward.
Right, Mr. Elliott with the last question.
Mr. Packer, several of the witnesses who appeared before us have speculated about what they see as the future role of newspapers versus television, the communications industry generally. I wonder, just in conclusion, would it be possible to ask you, in terms of your background experience, particularly with discussion in this country about pay TV and other things, I mean, where do you think newspapers are going in terms of their role in our media? Is it going to change dramatically, do you think? A bit of a crystal ball on what you think that it's likely to be like.
It's hard to know exactly. I'm sure newspapers per se will exist. Now, they may not be delivered the same way as they're delivered today. I mean, there may well be a printer in your home, and it may come over the television channel or the radio or whatever the hell it is, or off a cable, and that paper may be in effect printed at home. It may be part of a television service. I don't know what it's going to be. I'm sure it won't be as it is today, but I'm sure the printed word delivered in the form of a newspaper won't disappear either.
Do you think newspapers, in terms of what we've traditionally known, that them as will lose their influence in that sense, or as much influence as perhaps they've had in setting agendas and so forth?
I'm sure that newspapers today don't have the same degree of influence that they had before radio, before television. I mean, they are less today than they were, and before too much longer, there's going to be television of a type which is going to bring you the news from around the world, and therefore the news from around the world will be available on a 24-hour basis or whatever it happens to be. And newspapers will decline again and again. Having said all that, I think they will remain very influential for as far out as I can see, which is a lot further than I expect to be around for. And I think television will fragment, and I think it would be a great pity when it does, because if you look at what's happened to the standard of television in countries where it's fragmented too much, it's gone downhill. And I think there is a great misunderstanding of pay television, which is highly elitist. The only people who can pay for it and afford to pay for it are people who are better off. It is very detrimental on ordinary television and will do a great deal of damage to the ordinary television system, which is very good in this country, I think, very good. That will come about because at the moment you have three or four windows. You've got a window which is a film, which starts in the cinema. It then goes to a video shop. You know, 6 months later, it then goes from there, it will go to pay television, and then it will go to free television. There won't be one extra movie made because you've got introduced pay television between free television and the video shop. There won't be one extra movie made. What will happen is that people will see on free television their movies a year, 2 years later. There will be one movie channel. One movie channel will bring you 60 movies, 70 movies a month at the moment. out of the television stations in prime time alone, between the four television stations, you are seeing in excess of that number of movies per month anyway. Channel 9 runs 5 in prime time per week. So that's 20 a week. By the time you get the others in there and the ABC, it's in excess of that. The movie windows will get later, and the movies will be less relevant. And I think it's a great pity. I can see that it's, there's been a commitment made politically to do it. I think it's a mistake, but that's the way it's going to go. So I think ordinary television, over-the-air television, will get less significant. Pay television will be expensive, and also is going to be delivered by the wrong system in this country. And all of that money that is spent on that system over the next 10 years will then be completely wasted, because you'll go to an entirely different system and you'll have to re-equip again, which will be a disaster. And I think it'll be bad on the balance of payments. I think it's got a whole range of things which are wrong. But nobody's asked me to talk about that. Sorry, I'm rambling on.
It sounds to me like there's an opening for the broadcast of parliamentary committee hearings, perhaps. If there are no further questions, I'd like to thank Mr. Packer very much for appearing this afternoon.
Thank you.